everyone. Welcome to our first ever virtual commencement ceremony for our Master of Arts degree students in the human dimensions of organizations here at UT Austin. I am Amy Ware, Director of HDO. As many of you know, HDO's mission is to teach our students how to apply the social sciences and the humanities in the workplace. Today's graduates fulfilled that mission with aplomb. This ceremony, online or in person, is important for many reasons. First, it marks the end of a journey that started when today's graduates, a group of innovative mid-career professionals, each juggling distinct blends of family, career, and personal obligations, dedicated themselves to exploring the human experience. This seventh cohort of graduates come with extensive experience in fields such as transportation, medicine, public education, landscape architecture, sales, law enforcement, and finance, to name a few. You 20 students dedicated yourself to the study of human-centered workplace challenges. And as I promised you early on, it's not for the academically faint of heart, but here you are. Let's not forget the people who helped you along the way. The outstanding faculty who work with HDO prepared you to research and explore still unanswered questions you will encounter at work and in life. In class, they introduced you not only to the content of their courses, but also to the research methods you will continue to use as tools to identify, analyze, and solve challenges that will arise in your work lives. This year, the faculty smoothly moved their classes online so that you could continue your education despite the intrusion of COVID. All of us wish we were together in person, but we're hopeful that this virtual celebration will provide a space for graduates, families, and friends to come together and cheer. Speaking of your families, I want to thank your supporters. Graduates, your family, friends, and colleagues have watched you work harder than you thought possible these last four semesters. I bet they took on a few chores and additional responsibilities to help you out. I know they are excited to have you back now that the program is done. Now I'd like to say a few words about our graduating students. One of the reasons I love my job is that I get to know all the students. There were the twinsies, Justin and Kevin, who wore matching shirts to each class. Dr. Amy Benedict, we learned, is able to solve nearly all personal and medical problems. It turns out that Jonathan could start a second career as a Zoom background designer. And Trent is our first official HDO songwriter. I am so thankful, most of all, that y'all survived Tablegate. Whew, that was a close one. In all seriousness, however, you each taught me a lot. Thank you for all you've done for me and for all of us. And now I'd like to tell you how we're going to proceed this afternoon. All our graduates have created capstone projects. These projects allow our students to draw on what they've learned over the past 15 months to tackle an organizational problem of their choice. Throughout this event, we'll hear from each of our students. They'll provide a brief overview of what they studied, how they conducted their research, and what results they found. Intermingled throughout these presentations are messages from several members of the HDO faculty and from Dr. Ann Stevens, Dean of the College of Liberal Arts. After the pre-recorded segment wraps up, we'll move to a live segment to highlight each of our graduates and allow them to interact with you. And now, without further ado, let's kick things off.
Hello, my name is Adrian Abeliz. My study's central focus is to investigate the effectiveness of implementing Microsoft Teams during a crisis by examining and analyzing how a local builder changed its internal procedures and processes during the COVID-19 pandemic. I used a combination of literature review, participant observation, and semi-structured interviews to conduct this study. In the study, the organization transitioned to Microsoft Teams by creating and following a specific training and implementation plan. In the end, the new system eliminated the need for physical in-person meetings, thus removing the risk of catching COVID-19. The new system also changed how information was passed from senior leadership to the community team and stopped the use of paper products to align with the organization's My Home, My Earth program. Even though the transition to virtual teams was a success, some issues need to be resolved. The most frequent problem that was spoken about during the semi-structured interviews was information overload. One of the participants commented, "How do they expect me to get anything done when they keep pinging me and I have to stop and look at my phone or computer?" Overall, the organization did an outstanding job transitioning to a virtual team environment because it followed a straightforward formula of consistent mapping, repetition, and constant contact between senior leadership and the community team. With the change to virtual teams, internal crisis communication between the organization and the employees improved significantly, leading to improved sense-making and productivity. Since more organizations are transitioning to virtual teams, I agree with other researchers that more research and theory is needed to help inform organizations in designing, structuring, and managing virtual teams in the future. Thank you.
I'm Dr. Amy Benedict, a pediatric anesthesiologist in South Texas and a Master's of Arts candidate in the human dimensions of organizations. The well-being of healthcare workers who devote their lives to caring for others is often neglected. The COVID-19 pandemic has created an urgency in addressing heightened stress and anxiety. With this in mind, I developed and implemented a wellness program called Wellness Works for staff taking care of patients at an outpatient surgery center. I also collected data on common stressors affecting these workers and measured their psychological safety. The program consisted of on-site peer support sessions attended by small groups. The data was collected from surveys, wellness sessions, and interviews with leadership. Results showed that initially the primary stressors were adjusting to radical changes in the delivery of patient care and decreased paychecks. As the pandemic persisted, worries became the lack of supervision for dependents at home and decreased combined family income as partners became underemployed. Workers revealed high psychological safety scores, indicating they felt comfortable sharing patient care issues with their coworkers. Some of the identified stressors could be modified to help these providers, while others could not. Employee participation and feedback was overwhelmingly positive. In conclusion, with the support of strong leadership, Wellness Works, a peer support program for healthcare workers, was easily and successfully implemented in a surgery center. It provided critical emotional support during a pandemic. Wellness Works can be widely applied in multiple healthcare settings, embracing and promoting a supportive work environment.
Engineering is the least diversified STEM field. Even after 20 years of focused effort to recruit and retain women, their number in the workforce increased to only 13%. And of those, 50% leave within a few years. To research the persistent problem, I reviewed and analyzed decades of existing research. I also conducted original research with semi-structured interviews with 8 women engineers. Additionally, I wrote 2 case studies to engage the women's problem-solving training to address workplace issues, and then I analyzed the data using discourse analysis. This study theorizes that there is a group of powerful antiquated myths embedded in engineering culture, which are disseminated through the complex socialization process in engineering education and workplace. These myths are engineering's longstanding practices and norms that became invisible ideals of who and what an engineer is and ceased being questioned for their validity. Over time, they assumed a myth-like status. These myths wield the power to obscure engineering's view of how women engineers are marginalized and diminished within its culture, and they have resisted decades of empirical evidence that contradicts them. The study found that these antiquated myths also obscure women's vision of archaic and flexible systems surrounding them in engineering. But it also revealed that when these sanctioned myths came into direct conflict with the reality of the engineering workplace, women engineers became disillusioned and left. And this study confirms when women are honestly asked, they know why they leave engineering and what would make them choose to stay. Engineering does not have an unsolvable problem. Women say why they're leaving, but to hear them, engineering needs to dismantle the antiquated myths embedded in its culture and systems. Engineering must choose if it wants to be rooted in outdated myths from an earlier era or in a gender-diverse future.
Humanizing the contract-based relationship, the role of trust in outsourcing. During my experience as both a contractor and a consultant to transportation infrastructure clients, I've seen that people tend to focus on the contract document when problems arise on projects. I wanted to use the HDO capstone assignment to explore an alternative approach to problem solving in this context, focusing not on the contract document, but on the relationship between the private and public sector organizations involved. I surveyed Department of Transportation and highway maintenance contractors in Florida to find out, one, how much does one group trust the other? And two, is there a correlation between trust and performance? I received over 70 survey responses that covered 40 highway maintenance projects in Florida. I found that contractors trusted the department more than the department trusted contractors. There was a positive correlation between trust and performance for contractor respondents, but not for department respondents. Improved performance did not necessarily lead to improved trust, and people working on the same project for the same organization could have very different perspectives of trust in their client or contractor. This suggests that the foundations of trust are different for contractor and department representatives, and that organizational identity as well as personal experience of the respondent matter. The implications for those working on infrastructure projects are potentially extensive. I hope to build on this research to support continuous improvement efforts in outsourced project and program management. Qualitative analysis, interviews with survey respondents, would help identify the meaning behind these results and explain why the relationship between trust and performance isn't so straightforward, particularly for the department.
My name is Raksha Joshi, and I'm a teacher in Austin ISD. Currently, I teach fifth grade reading, writing, and social studies. Each year, students start school with different instructional needs. One way schools address these various learning needs is through small group instruction. Parents want their children to learn and grow, and as community members, this is a relevant issue to ensure young people stand on solid foundation as they transition to adulthood. I was interested in exploring how well and how consistently my campus implemented small group instruction. To learn more, I surveyed 26 staff members and conducted 13 follow-up interviews. I also interviewed one expert on small group instruction. Based on the preliminary survey data, teachers reported that they were slightly more confident in their own implementation versus the campuses. Teachers were also mixed in their confidence in their own implementation versus in assisting a colleague, which is important because teachers are highly encouraged to collaborate. Based on the follow-up interviews, some barriers to implementing small group instruction included time to plan and the instructional minutes available in the day, knowledge or the training required to implement small group instruction, as well as the additional work and effort required beyond planning daily lessons. Some teachers reported what kept them motivated, including prioritizing it and making it a non-negotiable, using this time to build relationships with students in small groups, and seeing results and seeing student growth. Additional supports needed include management for the classroom, collaboration, coaching and observation from experts and coaches, and a culture change where all teachers are encouraged to collaborate and share best practices of small group instructions. Based on this, two recommendations include creating an optional support group to share specific strategies for small group instruction and providing professional development and coaching through the Meadows Center for Preventing Educational Risk at UT. Over time, this culture for small group instruction can grow. Thank you for your time.
Hi, my name is Logan Kinder, and I'm a master's candidate in the Human Dimensions of Organizations program, the University of Texas at Austin. My capstone was military to consulting, experiences and perceived value of veterans transitioning into the management consulting industry. The military fosters several positive professional traits that are valuable in the civilian workforce. Past research shows that the top 100 military-friendly firms had a significantly higher financial return than firms that did not identify as military-friendly. However, nearly a third of veteran job seekers are still underemployed. This is a rate over 5% higher than non-veteran job seekers. It's worth noting that management consulting is the fifth largest industry that veterans go into after the military. The current study took a qualitative approach to explore perceived value of veterans in consulting, challenges faced by veterans in consulting, and factors that contribute to a successful military transition into the consulting industry. The methodology used for this study was 12 interviews conducted with both veterans and non-veterans with business and consulting experience. The research findings suggest 10 benefits of veterans in consulting: leadership, communication, teamwork, learning agility, analytical skills, creativity, structure, adaptability, perseverance, and global experience. The findings also suggest a few challenges faced by veterans in consulting. Civilian misperceptions. Veterans' misperceptions of their civilian peers. Unstructured environments. Corporate world biases and partiality. Lack of hard skills. Communication differences. Overconfidence and overmotivation. Finally, the findings suggest a few transition factors to be considered by any military members considering a profession in consulting. First, start planning early. Know your long-term goals. Be persistent. Be confident and learn to network. Ensuring that veterans transfer into careers that align with their professional competency, such as consulting professions, gives them a sense of purpose after military service, brings value to business organizations, and has economic advantages for society. To conclude, I would like to thank my HDO classmates, the HDO faculty and staff, my advisor, Dr. Art Markman, my second reader, Dr. Elizabeth Keating, for all the shared experiences, knowledge, and support. For more information, please feel free to email me at logan.kinder@gmail.com. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Brandy Mills. I believe deeply that place and space have the power to impact people's outcomes, be it where they live, learn, work, heal, or the communities they call home. All people should have access to spaces that inspire them. And the people that design these spaces should understand the lived experience of the people they are serving through the power of place. It is even more evident in this period where we are navigating COVID-19 that people of color experience disparate outcomes in many areas of life, and architecture and design is no exception. Representation matters in architecture and design, and people of color are highly underrepresented in the field. For this study, I engage with Black women in architecture and design with the goal of understanding their lived experience in the field and generating recommendations for improving it. In the interviews, three primary themes bubbled up. Number one, the invisible woman, which surrounds feelings of marginalization. Number two, the myth of the angry Black woman or the Black superwoman, so either a stereotype to overcome or an expectation of superhuman performance. And number three, working under the white gaze, which requires some level of code switching or conformity to be palatable to those who hold the power. As an outcome, I've provided some recommendations for employers and allies, for Black women early in career, and for Black women with privilege to impact outcome for others. The sum of it is that the multiplicative impact of the intersectionality of race and gender combined with underrepresentation present unique challenges for Black women in A&D. There's a relative permanency of place and space. So the consequences of underrepresentation impact communities of color for generations. It is critical to seize the energy generated by the dual pandemics of racism and COVID-19 to escalate representation in the field. Thank you.
Hey, 2020 graduates. You know, since your intensive week, I knew you were a special group when you showed up a couple of days into class all in matching burnt orange shirts just to get Trap Hagen's attention. So from then, I knew you were going to be a class that could really take on anything. And who knew all of the things that we were going to have to deal with over the course of this year. But when I was teaching in the spring, you guys really handled the switch to all online, all remote, really incredibly well. And I'm deeply appreciative of that. I've enjoyed working with several of you on your capstone projects, and I wish you all the success in the world. Please do keep in touch with all of your successes.
Hi, it's Davita Charney. And I want to add my congratulations to everyone in the cohort for finishing up. And we're in 2020, which is such a strange year. So I want to say that I feel very lucky to have met all of you in the flesh at Schultz's Garden back at the one of the term beginning dinners. I got to eat some queso and chips and drink possibly the worst glass of wine I've ever had and meet with a number of you. And I want to say that I really appreciated learning about what you all go through in your jobs and the kinds of amazing things that you do. Some of the vivid cases and narratives that you wrote for class are going to stick with me, like, Brandy getting some amazing women together in the room and empowering them at her workplace, and Amy doing the same with first responders in a clinical setting and helping them find the resilience to get through this crazy pandemic situation. And also learning and realizing some things about myself from some of you, like due to Matt, I now think of myself as an older worker. Thanks a lot, Matt. And I think about situations that are similar in my life to some of the things that have come up, like, oh my God, Adrian having to desperately try and get someone on the phone who's not answering to placate a potential home buyer who is unhappy about the grade of the yard in the back of the house. Oh my God. And so everyone in the class, I think, really, you had an impact on us, and we hope we had a positive impact on you. I'm looking forward to hearing wonderful things about what you accomplish in the world with all the skills and strategies and concepts and networks and other things that you've gained from HDO. Best of luck and congratulations.
Hey, class. Just wanted to take a moment and wish you so well, so wish you so much luck in things going forward. Graduation is exciting but bittersweet. I am bursting with pride and knowing that when I taught you in the spring, it was really that moment when the reality of the capstone was hitting you, and it at the same time felt so very far, far away. And to know that you've reached this point and finished that huge milestone and finished the program, I'm so excited for you. And I'm so glad that we get to use you as veterans who in turn can help the next group know that they'll get through. So I also just recognize what a bitter year this was, and whether it's my undergrads or you, I just marvel at how you coped, how you responded to setbacks, and how you found ways to power through. So incredibly proud of you, so happy for you, and I'm just glad I got to know you. You guys are an amazing cohort. Take care and have a great time celebrating.
This research work seeks to gain insight into the challenges professional women face returning to the workforce after a career break taken to raise children. This work reviews the literature, examines the reentry resources, and gleans employment information from a sample of 250 women. Interviews were conducted with 8 mothers who all returned to the workforce after a break to identify similarities and successes in reentry. I was able to identify, categorize, and understand the barriers that exist and evaluate the effectiveness of bridges that facilitate reentry efforts. The findings show the barriers are well entrenched, physically, societally, and psychologically. This work can serve as a conduit for women who desire to restart their careers and to the companies that want and need to increase female representation in their workforce. Companies need to understand and value female candidates with nonlinear careers rather than negatively judging career breaks and gaps. My goal is for any reader of this compilation to have a shift in the way they view women's career paths. See the whole person, not just work history, when evaluating the potential of a female candidate returning to the workforce after a career break.
We discuss many groups in the workplace. This cohort will all be part of one someday, older knowledge workers. Retirements are 2 million year over year, and COVID made 2020 3 million. Fewer workers are supporting those not working, which means higher taxes and lower growth. With too few to replace them, they walk out the door with tacit knowledge taught in manuals. Their sense of the right time to go is outmoded, centered on 65, a 1930s construct. Two theories stuck out to me: age stratification, which speaks to conflict of age norms and age realities, and socio-emotional selection, the fear of missing out on emotionally meaningful time as one ages. But the research is about personality and societal themes, not so much on organizational influence. How does the workplace affect all this? I wanted to learn first, what does it even mean to be an older worker? And second, how can employers react to age norms to retain top older workers? This was to learn what they experience and how. Significant statements from 15 in-depth interviews, a typical amount, would tell me what drives their thinking to stay or go, and what ideal situations would make them stay. From their narrative, these themes arose. An ideal situation is more control of time, giving back, and leveraging expertise. They didn't need to adopt new roles. They felt wisdom of age and experience, but also got dissed sometimes. They weren't approached as potential flight risks and weren't asked to brainstorm their work environments. But this isn't all on the employer, as the workers weren't proactive and employers fear crossing privacy lines. Other older workers didn't always represent them well, they knew, and at work this was mostly a solitary experience. So what to do? Recognize a special work status for top older workers with options for time and for bestowing honor. Make the options recognize individuality. Let them do their existing roles well or match current skills to jobs. But importantly, make it a deal, not an accommodation.
In this project was what, if any, changes to individual motivation have occurred in the U.S. Armed Forces over the last 20 years. We already know from personal experience, firsthand accounts, history lessons, and movies that during wartime, motivation is readily available. The motivation to simply make it home to friends and family is powerful, and it pushes men and women to their limits to accomplish the mission. But how do these same men and women get excited and stay motivated for work when it's just that, work? None of us should be surprised that the things that make ordinary employees click are the same things that push members of the military. Awards, recognition, promotions, all of these things have a hand in keeping troops motivated. A little underwhelming, I know. Something that did surprise me, though, was the overwhelming response I got when I asked interview subjects what it was that provided them the most motivation during tough times. Like most, I view the military as a team sport, and while I was on active duty, I relied heavily on the team approach to accomplish many things. But the one thing all of my interviewees had in common was their reliance on intrinsic motivation, a push from within themselves to keep going. It seems the tide is shifting from the team sport aspect and moving into combining individual effort to move forward. Perhaps this is a reflection of the movement of society today. Perhaps it's something else. Time will tell.
The purpose of this research study is to build on the core values of my firm, which are intended to give all staff members a voice in the process of design and implementation of ideas. I argue through this study that our standard process of creative collaboration, brainstorming, is limited and faces challenges of providing equity of voice to all, which subsequently reduces the amount of powerful, creative, and innovative design strategies. Over the past 3 months, I have worked with staff to test new models of creative collaboration as part of our one-hour design review sessions. New models are based on Van Gundy's brain writing tools, which are focused more on individual idea generation in group settings. Across the firm of 8 offices, we rolled out 6 tools for creative collaboration within a variety of group settings. The tools include unstructured brainstorming, the standard free-for-all process that the firm utilizes, structured brainstorming, brain writing, and 3 brainstorming brain writing hybrids such as the SIL method, role storming, and photo stimulation. Overall, the brain writing tools received very positive feedback from staff participating. In this remote environment, brainstorming appears to be at a significant disadvantage due to the difficulties with virtual communication. Brainstorming did not result in additional ideas or an equity of voices and did not foster strong staff connections. In many brainstorming sessions, collaborators did not even speak. Brain writing showed a much stronger connection to staff during the collaboration process. In the brain writing sessions, all staff had time to speak and articulate ideas. Brain writing generally focuses all participants to engage and participate and makes their time useful. The study will continue for multiple more months before a formal rollout in the firm, but there were very notable key observations during this first phase. 1, group size matters. Sessions should aim to be between 5 and 8 participants. Brainstorming is more difficult while working remotely, that was noted. Photo stimulation and role storming received very positive feedback from the group, and brain writing produces more ideas. And finally, the facilitator is key to the entire process.
Hi, everyone. My name is Emily Perryman, and my capstone is about understanding leader identity and the factors that influence it. More specifically, I wanted to investigate if these influences changed as someone went further into their career. So first, what exactly is leader identity? Quite simply, it's the part of someone's identity that relates to being a leader or how someone thinks of themselves as a leader. This may sound pretty obvious, but it's incredibly important. Professionals who have a strong leader identity are going to be far more likely to seek out and take advantage of opportunities to improve themselves, which in turn should create more effective leaders. I used a mixed methods approach for my research that included an online survey as well as one-on-one interviews. Both of these formats included professionals in all working age ranges, from people just starting out in their careers in their 20s to professionals in their 60s. I also interviewed 2 talent development managers to learn a little bit more about how companies approach leader development. Of the 4 major influences shown here, the most interesting pattern I heard about in the interviews was the influence of people's fathers on their leader identity. Taking into account the influences I heard about, how early in people's careers or even lives those influences occurred, and then how companies approach formal leader development training, it became painfully obvious that employers are waiting far too long to offer this type of training. They are missing out on the key identity-forming years earlier in people's careers, and often waiting until people are already in leadership positions before putting them into leader development training.
The premise of my capstone is that art can act to influence thought and social awareness, which can bring about change. I conducted 3 case studies of artists' exhibitions that generated controversy: Robert Mapplethorpe, The Perfect Moment, Sam Durant, Scaffold, and The City by Vincent Valdez, a work shown right here at the Blanton Museum. I interviewed the artist, Vincent Valdez, Veronica Roberts, a curator at the Blanton, and a museum trustee. I also utilized archival materials and web-based data. I analyzed the facts, dilemmas, and challenges museums face when considering an exhibition of controversial work. In conclusion, museum exhibitions can be effective tools for artists to address issues oftentimes before the public is either aware or willing to confront them. I am hopeful my research offers suggestions to complicated issues museums face when dealing with controversial material.
The path that we have all taken together has been an interesting one. The HDO 2020 cohort is deeply grateful to HDO faculty and staff for the passion, commitment, and dedication you have shown to our success, despite the challenging circumstances that befell us all. Thank you. With that said, we are honored to announce that the HDO Class of 2020 Outstanding Professor Award goes to Dr. Paul Woodruff. We spent some time with Herman Melville in Dr. Woodruff's class, and this quote by Melville exemplifies Dr. Woodruff's spirit. We cannot live only for ourselves. 1,000 fibers connect us with our fellow men. We will share a few comments from the 2020 cohort that expressed what your leadership has meant to us, Dr. Woodruff. Justin Naylor says, "The way Dr. Woodruff embraced technology during the initial days of the pandemic was inspiring. When many were balking at the idea of going totally virtual, he led the charge to ensure we still receive the best experience possible." Leslie Diamond said, "Dr. Woodruff did not simply teach us about leadership. He showed us what intrinsic leadership looks like. He encouraged us to question our assumptions, look past the surface at driving motivations, and grasp the complexity of the human capacity for both destruction and inspiration. He modeled the most valuable characteristics of a true leader, humility. Dr. Woodruff is a rare leader who embodies strength, compassion, and humility. He uses his gifts to expand minds and empower souls." Adrian Arroyo said, "Dr. Woodruff, I feel like COVID has dropped me smack dab in the center of one of your literary case studies. How do we show courage and leadership in the face of uncertainty? Why does being fair so often lead to injustice? Your lessons were just as much about being a better human as they were about being a more thoughtful leader. I thank you for giving me the words and ideas to talk to others about how living in the gray areas between principles shows respect for the intelligence, diversity, and humanity of those around us." Carrie Monroe said, "Thank you for introducing me to readings that will forever stay with me. Billy Budd, Thucydides, Bartleby the Scrivener, The Birmingham Letter. Thank you for leading us in meaningful discussions on tyranny, respect, justice, and my favorite, compassion. Thank you for showing up on a bike in a bow tie and reflecting all the leadership you teach about so beautifully." Jacqueline Brown quotes Alexandra F. Trenfor in saying, "The best teachers are those who show you where to look but don't tell you what to see." Jacqueline says, "Dr. Woodruff, it was an honor to be in your HDO class. You made challenging material approachable and fun. You inspired me to be a better student. I truly enjoyed every minute of your class." And finally, Emily Perryman says, "I love Dr. Woodruff's class for two reasons. First, looking at leadership through the lens of literature made each reading in class so vibrant and lively. These were the readings I looked forward to because I knew they would stay with me long after the class was over. Second, the day Dr. Woodruff put his bicycle on the table and told us how good writing was like a bicycle changed how I look at everything. Hands down, best metaphor ever." We spent time with Machiavelli in Dr. Woodruff's class, and Machiavelli wrote that it must be considered that there is nothing more difficult to carry out, not more doubtful of success, nor more dangerous to handle than to initiate a new order of things. Machiavelli also wrote that everyone who wants to know what will happen ought to examine what has happened. Everything in this world in any epoch has their replicas in antiquity. That is a lesson that Dr. Paul Woodruff has imparted unto us that has helped us navigate our current uncertainties and will guide us through future uncertainties. Dr. Woodruff, from the Masters HDO Class of 2020, congratulations. You are our Outstanding Professor of the Year. Thank you.
to the wonderful 2020 cohort of the HDO MA program, I want to say congratulations on many jobs well done. And thank you for voting me a teaching award. There's a certain irony in this for me because, as you probably know, I am a Socratic, and Socrates didn't believe that he ought to be a teacher at all on a subject like ethics. And I, of course, believe that leadership belongs to ethics. So I have some doubts about my role as a teacher, and therefore I contrive in a course like ours that most of the teaching is done by you, who are ostensibly the students, and a substantial amount of the learning gets to be done by me. Thank you for that. I've learned a lot from you. The other day, I looked back at the papers you wrote for our class at the end of the semester, and I was impressed all over again. What a range of important topics. What fine work you did. Much of it is more relevant now than ever. You wrote about leadership in crisis, great leadership departures, innovation, trust, change, stress, especially stress among those who work in providing medical care. And then, of course, there were the humanistic topics that warmed my heart, like translations of the Bible, the history of Queen Elizabeth I, and the courage of Antigone. Thank you for all of that. I predict that all of you will be blessings for whatever organizations are fortunate enough to have your leadership. I give you all best wishes for the future. Congratulations, and thank you very much.
Many congratulations on this wonderful day of your graduation with a master's degree. As a professor, I always experience a thrill when someone I've taught achieves a graduate degree. I know what it takes, all that hard work and belief in yourself, the late nights, the uncertainties, lots of exciting reading to do, and then hours and the determination that writing demands in order to find your voice to contribute to the literature. I know firsthand the sacrifices that you've made and the perseverance you've shown, not to mention the work of finding a topic among all the possible topics. Not everyone has what it takes, and you have what it takes. And for myself, I've really enjoyed being part of your journey this year and a half. Your accomplishments are amazing. I can still remember your first days in class and watching your acceleration into the academic life. And then listening to your very exciting projects just a semester later. And I'm very confident that you have a lot of new resources and skills to achieve even more personal fulfillment. So I feel very lucky to have known you, and I hope you'll stay in touch. And congratulations once again.
Congratulations, class of 2020. So proud of you guys. Every time I saw you this summer, you were on the verge of some virtual happy hour, those late Saturday afternoons. So now it's probably no different. I really enjoyed our time together. It seemed like by the time I met you guys already developed into your own family with your own peculiar in-jokes and your own language and lots of chatter, lots and lots of chatter. So thank you for admitting me into that small universe, and really proud of what you accomplished. And I am certain that you're gonna go on and redesign your organizations and your lives in really interesting ways. So I can't wait to see that, and please keep me posted. Congratulations.
To the top,
well, you knew there had to be one more piece of music. So, gratulire, félicitations, felicidades, pazdravlayu, mabruk. I could keep on playing with words and say, as I imagine you've already guessed, congratulations, even the last version being said with a British accent. I just had to take a moment. I can't begin to express how impressed I am by all of you, by the work you've done. How could we ever have imagined, as we were standing in the Blanton Museum on a hot summer day in August of 2019, where we would be, as we are now in November and December of 2020. The HDO MA program is a remarkable, a heroic, and exceptional undertaking and achievement every year. To have done it this year, amidst pandemics, elections, all the other stresses that have been experienced by each of us individually and by our world, is something for which, frankly, I don't have words. Not a problem I usually have. But I hope, despite how strange the year has been, how hard I know it's been, that you'll be able to take a few moments truly to understand the remarkable achievement, the remarkable intervention that each one of you has been making. Not just your coursework, not just working with IRB. Your capstones, of course, are one of the most distinctive, memorable, positive, and impactful parts of this program. Those of you that I've had the pleasure of mentoring and working with over the last year, I know your work well. I also look forward so much to experiencing and understanding all the projects that I didn't get to see develop in real time. And yet, based on conversations held in the IC Squared building almost exactly 1 year ago, I can imagine the kinds of remarkable things that you all accomplished. I always try to finish briefly and shortly, not running over, beginning with a song, Imagine Dragons, suggesting that you really have done something remarkable. It's time, and you need to give the Academy a rain check, but I could not be more grateful that you decided to spend the last 18 months, initially face-to-face and in person, and ultimately virtually, with me and my colleagues on the staff and faculty of HDO. But I have to give you a quotation. I won't play around with screen sharing, all these things we used not to have to do, and give you images or a movie clip. But I have to give you one little quotation to allow art to speak, literature in this case, to speak at this last moment. And it's probably no big surprise that the person I've selected is my main English language author, Oscar Wilde. He's full of clever, paradoxical remarks. Many of them are critiquing society. And HDO asks you to think critically about yourselves, about all of us, about our communities, both here and across the planet. But I want to give you a friendly Oscar Wilde, not one of his really satirical moments. He asks us to reflect on the following paradox. To live is the rarest thing in the world. Most people exist. That's all. With all the suffering that's around us and all the ways in which your projects have intervened to help us to understand that, to improve that. Above all else, perhaps, what you have shared with us is what it means to live. And that's rare, not merely to be in the world, to exist in the world, but to reflect upon it, to make change, to help us to understand change that we did not make, and to lead. So in this virtual moment, of course, I'll be at the graduation as well, virtually, of course, rather than in person. In this last virtual moment, well done. Heartiest congratulations. I look forward to connecting with you for years, seeing all the spaces and places and lives in which you continue to intervene. And I want just to take the moment to thank you for the transformative experience you've had on me and my life and my way of thinking about things as well. Congratulations.
Hello, I'm Trent Sizemore, a master's student in the HDO program at the University of Texas at Austin. My capstone project is twofold, a one-hour documentary and a 50-page capstone paper on the recreational vehicle industry. In this project, I explore the 100-year history of the recreational vehicle industry and also explore the problems that plague that industry today. The issues I addressed were supply chain in nature and dealt primarily with the repair event cycle time for the end consumer. I also looked at the problem of capacity issues in our park system that affect the amount of time that the end consumer can actually use their RV. This capstone is ethnographic in nature. I used experimental, qualitative, interview, and historical inquiry to gain insight and better understanding of these issues. Here's a 30-second trailer of the documentary. I hope you enjoy watching. So you've really been RVing for almost 75 years. The RV industry is kind of accidental exploration.
What are we doing to make sure we have capacity for all the campers?
There doesn't seem to be any quality control.
And sometimes they can be waiting weeks.
That's a detriment to the industry.
What caused those companies to go out of business?
The rest of the industry were basically fishing in a sea of sameness.
Hi, I'm Mandy Trimbaugh, Master's of Arts candidate in the HDO program at the University of Texas at Austin. For my capstone, I chose to do a literature review on the importance of diversity in executive leadership, and then went on to develop a mentoring program for women and minorities to ensure that all have the opportunity to develop professionally with the ability to one day have a seat at the table. Having a diverse leadership team accomplishes so many things, such as giving a voice and representation to a diverse employee base. It attracts and retains top talent, and it also encourages different ways of problem solving. I went on to write a recommendation report to the company I work for, encouraging the implementation of a mentorship program for women and minorities. This mentorship program would contain two different phases. The first phase would be that of shadowing. They would have the ability to shadow each executive or somebody from their team, and determine whether or not that was that career path was of interest to them. After the 22 weeks of shadowing, we do have 22 executives at our company. After the 22 weeks of shadowing, they could then choose one to two executives to meet with again and have any questions answered before moving on to phase two. In phase two, the participant would determine the desired career path that they want to take, choose a mentor, and then for the next year, every month, the mentor and the mentee would meet and would go over their goals, set new goals for that month. And there would also be accountability for both the mentor and the mentee to make sure that that fit was still a good one and that both of them were working together well to get that participant to the next step. I'd like to share one quote with you before I let you go. If you want to harvest in 1 year, grow a crop. If you want to harvest in 10 years, grow trees. If you want a harvest that will last a lifetime, grow people. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Jonathan Thompson. During my 20 years in the window film industry, I have witnessed the evolution in this niche market, which led me to the Capstone Project. The goal was to discover if personality traits among installers exist, and at the same time, discover demographics about the industry. This information will later be used to develop and standardize a hiring and training process to fill a necessary need for window film installers. An anonymous online survey was conducted and posted through social media, emailed and distributed by manufacturers and distributors. The survey had 143 participants who were asked to categorize their role as a dealer, business owner, as an installation company, installer, or other. The third portion of the survey was a 10-question Big Five personality test. The survey results came back to show that personality traits may exist with higher levels of conscientiousness, openness, and extroversion than the average American. The survey also confirmed it lacks diversity. The makeup is predominantly white males between the ages of 40 and 59 years of age. Overall, job satisfaction is very high across all positions, and all participants are likely to recommend somebody to begin a career in the window film industry. The results of the survey did conclude that overwhelmingly, dealers and business owners have a common concern: finding and training new installers. Additional research is recommended for manufacturers and the International Window Film Association to continue to sample installers and use the information collected in the survey to develop a standardized recruiting process. If you'd like to know more about the Capstone Project, please feel free to contact me at jonathanthompson@utexas.edu. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Joyce Wong. My topic is bridging the research gap of diversity, equity, and inclusion initiatives for the Asian community during COVID-19 in Austin. In early 2020, some politicians framed coronavirus as Chinese virus. There's a limited research on the impact of this label on the Asian community. For the city of Austin, Asian is the fastest growing demographic group. It is important to better understand the experience. In this research, I collected 145 surveys and conducted 16 interviews. Here are the results I found. In Austin, there's a slight increase in cases of micro inequalities, verbal harassment, and physical assaults towards Asian during COVID-19. The number of cases is lower than a national average reported by the Pew Research Center earlier this year. And some of my respondents share that they think Austin is safer than other cities in the United States, as Austin is diverse and has a well-educated, youthful population with value tolerance. However, I also found that the term Chinese virus has already posed negative impact on the Asian community. In my data, there's a statistically significant difference in terms of having fear that someone might threaten or physically attack them during COVID-19, especially among females. So to conclude, I think more bystander training should be organized to train the community members to speak up when others experience racism. Besides, more resources should be invested in helping Asians, especially females, in coping with the fear resulted by the term Chinese virus. Also, more research should be done on how COVID-19 has impacted Asian students in school as there are reported cases of racial slurs and jokes. Or it is the time for us to reflect on our own implicit bias for different races. Thank you very much.
Hi, thank you for joining me today to learn about my project, How Can Our Organization Lead Change to Improve Employee Engagement, Retention, and Quality Measures? For several years, our manufacturing plant was quantifying their quality measures and found that process errors were severely impacting quality outcomes. Productivity and quality goals were not being met, and a constrained production capacity was burdened by quality issues. Additionally, we were experiencing high employee turnover in key manufacturing areas, which was also contributing to our poor quality outcomes. The goal of this project was to research the literature to identify solutions for improving employee productivity, retention, and improving quality outcomes, and then also to survey our employees on specific measures of job satisfaction, including employee perception of opportunities and rewards, organizational support for training, employees' personal feelings about training, employee satisfaction regarding the training received, and employee openness to change in training and advancement within the organization. In research of the literature, it was concluded that frequent job training paired with promotion and rewards tied to quality measures equals greater job satisfaction within employees. And when employees are experiencing greater job satisfaction, they have greater engagement on the job. There's less employee turnover, and there's greater employee productivity. There's also improved quality measures and improved safety measures. So in taking, in executing the survey, the survey results showed that we have opportunity within our organization to focus efforts on the following key outcomes. we need to provide more opportunity and rewards within the organizations for employees. Increase our training opportunities to enable our employees to perform better and learn additional skills. Develop more advancement and promotion opportunities tied to completion of training goals and attainment of quality measures. And we should foster a learning organizational culture and intentionally hire employees who value learning and training. I'd like to acknowledge the help of Dr. John Traphagen as my advisor, Dr. Elizabeth Keating as my second reader, Dr. Davita Charning for her insight, George Smith, without whom this would not be possible. A very special thanks to my family, Bob, Summer, and Hunter, for their love and support during this effort. If you're interested in further information, you can contact myself, Laura Simon, at laura@vnlmanagement.com. Thank you for your interest.
Hello, my name is Adriana Merlot, and I'm excited to talk to you today about my incredible capstone project called Step Into the Light, which is an autoethnography for women leading through mental illness. Before we get into the nitty-gritty of the research, I want to tell you a quick backstory. You know the bathroom breakdown like the kind Julia Roberts had in the 2010 movie Eat, Pray, Love? The one where you feel the whole world is crashing down on you. And all you want to do is escape to Italy to learn a new language, eat pasta, and make your way to an Indian ashram, only to marry the love of your life in Bali. If I could pop on a plane to detox from the world in a charming Italian villa, trust me, I would. But the reality is I can't. I have 180 employees depending on me. And here's the crux of my research. How do I lead a company while I'm the youngest, inexperienced boss in a patriarchal culture while battling with mental health disorders? So if you take a look at the notebook on this side of my desk, my virtual desk, you can see that this paper will dissect the intersectionality of my identity, which includes being a young female boss trained in the US. Another aspect is my mental health disorders, only to end up with the final combination, which is Mexico's patriarchal work culture. So how did I go about this? First, I collected documentation from the past 6 years from being a young boss in Mexico. This documentation included therapy notes, video journalings, workbooks, evidence, and even a couple of data from my mental health assessments. Then I researched the existing literature on gender roles, class, mental health perceptions, and work culture in Mexico. This was extremely illuminating because although there's tons of research on mental health issues, leadership, female leadership, and Mexico's work culture, there isn't research putting it all together. So going back to my Venn diagram over here, you can see that this paper touches on all of those three aspects. Finally, I drafted an autoethnography for other women to lead through workplace and cultural struggles while dealing with mental health issues. So where are my key insights? One, women have to be strategic on how they choose to lead at work. We can't just play it off a whim. We have to be very careful about how we choose to present ourselves. Two, mental health issues do not decrease your value in the workforce. Three, investigating cultural nuances is key when working with an international team, and trust and courage are an elixir to powerful leadership. And this goes very similar to my conclusions. I learned that being the CEO of my wellness rather than a victim to my illness allows me to capitalize my strengths and showcase my humanity as a boss. Two, I was often been told, fake till you make it, be confident, portray a confident, charismatic leader. But in reality, I often felt that it was kind of inauthentic. So I've discovered that courage is the most powerful leadership resource. We can always tap into our courage whenever we need to, because courage means that you feel scared to do something and you do it anyways. Then I also learned that building trust and pastoral care for employees is vital to their sense of loyalty and safety within the organization. And finally, my last conclusion is that it's important to approach cultural gaps from a place of curiosity, and that being the boss doesn't mean you'll always be liked. The love-hate relationship of a boss is part of the role. The only thing that's truly in my hands is trying to convey my deep sense of caring for their well-being and the company. I hope this quick review has provided some insight so that you, that person who might be struggling with a mental health issue or know someone who might be struggling with a mental health issue, can step into the light and discover the joy of their unique personality and the unique role they can play as a leader within their organization. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Lewis Miller. I'm the assistant director of the HDO program. I'm sadly not joining you from Paris today, but rather participating in the new tradition of hiding a messy home with a Zoom background. I've been with the program for nearly 8 years now, and I have to say this day is always one of my favorites. It's been so exciting to see the fascinating ways in which our students have completed their projects over the past several months. The members of this cohort have done an amazing job putting everything that they've learned together into action to tackle difficult real-world organizational challenges. Seeing these projects come to fruition is so rewarding. I wish this cohort nothing but the best, and I feel lucky and honored to have gotten to know them over the past 15 months, and I really hope that connection continues. Thank you all for joining us today, and above all, thank you for lending us your loved ones for the past 15 months. I'm sure it hasn't been easy. But again, thanks, congrats to the class of 2020, and take care, everyone.
Hi, folks. We're now going to transition to our live segment. If you have not already, please turn on your video, if possible. We will start with a recognition of each of our class of 2020 cohort members. After calling each graduate's name, we invite them to address their friends, family members, colleagues, and anyone else they've invited here today. When we call the names of your graduate, we expect and encourage clapping, cheering, and the use of Zoom reactions. This is a celebration. Be loud. With that said, I thank you again for joining us for this unique graduation celebration. Hook 'em.